Distinguished delegates, colleagues and friends, very good afternoon. In the beginning, I would like to thank ICD for giving me this wonderful opportunity to come over here and share my views on the CEDAW Convention. I will speak on women's human rights. It's a different flavor of human rights. We know that 2012 marks the 30th anniversary of CEDAW Committee and 33rd years of CEDAW Convention. Today, I would like to highlight the achievements of the Convention over the past three decades and its impact all over the world on the women's advancement and through gains of women's rights and main challenges that it faced and those now lying ahead in its enforcement, with a special focus towards the role of women in governance and underlying causes of the underrepresentation of women in the public and political affairs. CEDAW Convention also targets CEDAW Convention was adopted by the General Assembly of the United Nations on 18 December 1979 with an aim to prohibit all forms of discrimination against women committed by public authorities or by any person or organization in the full range of civil, political, economic, social, and cultural rights covering both public and private life. The Convention also targets culture and tradition as the influential forces shaping gender roles. CEDAW is the only legally binding international instrument which defines what constitutes discrimination against women and sets up an agenda for national action to end such discrimination. You can see the picture. This is the CEDAW committee while I was there. The Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, a 23-person expert body, was established in 1982. The committee works through regular reporting process, which includes periodic reports, concluding observations, constructive dialogues, and follow-up mechanism. To ensure women's enjoyment of the human rights and fundamental freedoms, states parties as party to the convention are under the obligation to protect, respect, promote, and fulfill these rights. Guidance and monitoring measures of the CEDAW committee has significantly enhanced states' accountabilities for women's enjoyment of their human rights and shaped women's progress worldwide. At present, about 187 countries that have ratified CEDAW convention. But of course, the powerful country like USA still have not ratified CEDAW. I hope that the Obama administration will come forward and ratify the Women's Rights Bill, the CEDAW Convention. The CEDAW Convention's profound impact on legal and socio-political development of states parties is visible in the strengthening of institutional provisions for the protection of women's rights and efforts to bring existing legislation into conformity with the convention principles, improvement in the capacity of national institutions and gender budgeting to guarantee equality between men and women. The South African and Ugandan constitutions contain significant provisions of guaranteeing women's equality based on convention principles. Nepal's Supreme Court had relied on the convention in directing the government to address discriminatory laws, and Canada's Supreme Court had drawn on the convention and the committee's general recommendations on violence against women. Bangladesh has made an amendment in its citizenship law to bring equality in its application. Maldives has changed its discriminatory law as per the requirement of Article 7.1, Women in Public Life. CEDAW ratification provided the framework for a long-sought reform of family laws in Morocco. Our minister is here, Moroccan, Tunisia, and Turkey to bring equality in the family relationship. The groundbreaking introduction of Morocco's new family code in 2004 gave women greater equality and protection of their human rights within marriage and divorce, as mandated by Article 16 of the Convention. Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations recently cited particularly a representative example of these achievements in case of Rwanda, which has made huge gains in women's political participation since the genocide and accompanying violence against women in 1994. Also, general recommendations of the CEDAW made so much progress for advancement of women. The 28 general recommendations of the committee provided its members' collective view of appropriate measures to fulfill states' obligations under the convention. It helps to clarify and promote understanding of the rights protected by the convention and the specific nature of discrimination against women. Its general recommendation on female genital mutilation was the first attempt from the United Nations treaty body on this practice. Similarly, CEDAW Committee was also the first to adopt a general recommendation on HIV and AIDS. The groundbreaking general recommendation CEDAW Committee has taken in 2010 about the protection of the human rights of older women. And I feel so good that I was the chair of that committee, and we worked for about 3 years and CEDAW Committee and the United Nations had adopted this general recommendation number 27. This is the only blanket protection for the human rights of older women. Civil society and the NGOs with the CEDAW Committee is also an important element. Its expanding commitment to dialogue with civil society allowed the CEDAW Committee to examine issues from the rights perspective. Its concluding comments provided a framework for monitoring states' action and showed the committee's rigorous engagement with the states' parties. CEDAW and NGO working together in strong relationship achieved the major gains of the past 30 years through the contributions of NGO in reporting and monitoring implementation of the convention. Optional protocol is another weapon added to the CEDAW Committee, CEDAW Convention in 1999. UN Women and CEDAW, Ms. Bachelet, Executive Director of UN Women at the celebration of the 30th anniversary of the CEDAW on 9th July 2012 stated that, during past 30 years, the convention, particularly the work of the CEDAW Committee, has had remarkable impact. States have changed laws, policies, and programs to address violence against women and trafficking, to advance reproductive rights, to ensure women's rights in marriage and in divorce, to advance women's rights to the workplace and to land, property and inheritance, and women's rights have been enshrined in national constitution. However, discrimination against women still persists all over the world, and in very few countries have the convention directly been applied to the courts. Also, very few judges and policymakers have knowledge about the treaty, and the de facto discrimination against women remains universal. Though the convention has attained almost universal ratification by 187 countries, I told that the United States still not ratified CEDAW. The convention is mostly remained off the political agenda or been a low priority issue in many countries, despite their governments having become signatories. Governments and civil society stakeholders have lacked sufficient knowledge, capacity, and expertise to implement CEDAW, which in turn has had a negative impact on the sense of national ownership of the process. There has been also discomfort and resistance in some societies where CEDAW has been perceived as a challenge to accepted socio-cultural and religious norms. Now I come to the second part of my presentation, that is the participation of women in the public and political life. The last two decades have witnessed an increase in the women's representation in politics. Quotas have been introduced and have become an important mechanism to trigger women's access to political offices. Despite massive adoption of quotas, the increase in women's representation has remained limited. Global average of women's participation in politics at present is 19.5%. This is as per IPU statistics. Only and need to be balanced towards more equal representation. Women constitute 51% of the world's population, yet they are underrepresented in the political arena that make key decisions affecting their lives. 30 years of CEDAW, and 51% of women is a huge population, but their percentage in the public and political arena at present is 19.5%. As per 2008 report of the Inter-Parliamentary Union to the United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, only, this is the statistics of 2008, only 17.7% of the parliamentarians worldwide and 16.1% of ministers were women. Women's participation at the highest level of decision-making remains extremely weak. That is, 4.7% of women were heads of the state, 4.2% of women were heads of the government, and 10.7% of women were speakers of parliament. The CEDAW Convention prescribed application of quota through temporary special measures to accelerate women's full and equal participation in the governance at all levels and women's leadership in all decision-making process. Quota is very important that CEDAW committee has prescribed. Article 7 and 8 of the CEDAW explicitly cover the rights of women to non-discrimination in a country's public and political spheres, as well as their right to equality with men in regard to right to vote, and the right to be eligible for election to all publicly elected bodies. This democracy is not only to right to vote, but right to be elected should be there for women. General recommendations number 5, 8, 23, and 25 of the CEDAW committee are important for the discussion on quota system to increase the participation of women in public and political life. General recommendation number 23 of 1997 explicitly deals with article number 7 and 8. It echoes relevant paragraphs of the Beijing Platform for Action. Application of quota system is greatly emphasized in the general recommendation number 25 of 2004 concerning the article number 4.1 regarding the application of temporary special measures. There have been some truly groundbreaking results in countries such as Rwanda, Sweden, South Africa, Nicaragua, Timor-Leste, Liberia, and Nepal. Quotas are very effective in those countries. Nepal has the highest level of women's participation in parliament in the Asia-Pacific region with 33% of parliamentary seats. As in the case of Uganda, women are now more visible in leadership posts, having risen from under 10% in 2001 to about 35% in 2010. Bangladesh is an unique example of having women, both as prime minister and as opposition leader, for more than a decade. They are elected by popular vote. Also, reservation of seats for women at the local government has increased the number of women in the politics at the grassroots level. President Dilma Rousseff, maybe spelling may not be correct, is the first female president in the history of Brazil. Besides, Australia, Germany, Finland, Thailand, Liberia, and some other countries also have female heads of governments and heads of states. In the recent past, India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, United Kingdom, and Israel had women leadership in the top government positions. Despite some progress in women's representation in the public and political arena and massive adoption of quotas, women are still underrepresented in the public and political spheres due to highest level of gender discrimination and the least protection of women's political as well as social and economic rights in the society. In most cases, educated and eligible women cannot move further due to glass ceilings. Government top positions, secretaries, heads of the institutions or corporations are mostly occupied by men, though gender quotas are accepted as a principle of the governance. The level of participation of women as members of boards of directors is considerably lower than their participation in the overall workforce. In some countries, muscle power is important in politics, where women's control is very weak. Political violence and sexual harassment of women are important barriers in discharging their rights as a candidate or rights to vote. In the male-dominated society, women mostly have no control over money and finance due to lack of inheritance and right to the property and power. This is an important obstacle for women in politics, as money plays an important role in the election process. Besides, the implementation of quotas remains complex, requiring a number of parallel processes and measures. In order to be effective, they require concerted efforts of political parties, parliaments, electoral management bodies, public administration, civil society members, and general public. It's also true that quotas are controversial. Despite successes, opponents argue that quotas are discriminatory or undemocratic. We need to see more awareness of the positive effects of quotas through active participation of government institutions, election commission, as well as the broader involvement of general public. Many gender advocates are focused on promoting gender-responsive governance and greater female involvement in the electoral process. By encouraging women to stand for election, training, and mentoring female electoral candidates and educating voters about the importance of women's participation in public life. They have particularly advocated for the use of temporary special measures, such as quotas, to guarantee female representation in the parliament, also requiring political parties to nominate a certain number of women as candidates. In conclusion, I would like to say that power of cultural diplomacy can change, can bring a change in the mindset of common people, of political, attitude of government, and can bring a political will to change the situation, to change the stereotype about women's, rights. I think we can use, I can tell you as just, one story. While I worked in the Ministry of Women and Children in Bangladesh, in Bangladesh, trafficking of women and children and domestic violence is a huge problem like all other countries. So from our ministry, we launched a road march where to educate people, we use the media like street, drama, and we use the popular folk musics and all these things to educate our women and men regarding the laws about trafficking and laws about in the country. If they do not, if they are default, what a punishment is waiting for them, and why they should be they should take care of all these issues. Why they should avoid violence, why women should be respected and harassment in the workplace and all these things, why they should, it should be avoided, all these things. And it created a great, awareness among people. We have seen that in the countryside, women with burqas also, they came, to see the drama, to listen the all this, the recitation and all these things. I think this is an easy way to communicate, the laws of the, the country, and to communicate what messages we are giving to them. And also, this is very important. And another important thing, what we have started at that time while I was there, that the education, then schools and colleges, we proposed a change in the curriculum to bring gender education in our curriculum, so that the children and they grew up with the sense that the equality and gender issues they learn from the beginning. I think this is a very important issue. There's a tremendous power of cultural diplomacy could be used to change the stereotype. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.